brothers and sisters. I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be that you love the most unlovable part of me? Of me. How could you see your life was the only gift I left for me to be free? It's amazing with you. I win even if I lose. Everything's working for my good for always.
Come on.
He saves the day. Woo. He will come through. You all know that's not what superheroes do.
Hallelujah.
No greater love makes my heart beat. All I wanna do is make you proud of me.
That's why. I appreciate it.
A mystery.
It's amazing how
your patience with me, God will never leave.
You don't give up on me.
So heavenly.
Help me
to see like you.
Like you.
No matter what I go through,
hey.
Everything's working for my good for a way.
Let me tell you what he does.
He saves the day.
And he will.
He will come through.
Hallelujah.
Superheroes.
No greater love like this
makes my heart beat.
And I promise you,
all I want to do is make you proud of me.
Good morning. My name's Dave. This is my wife, Mary. We're going to be reading a psalm, but I wanted to say happy resurrection morning. Praise the Lord.
Okay.
And we're reading Psalm 27, 13 to 14.
I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord.
This is a psalm that has a very encouraging promise that God is real. And that we as his people, and that as we as his people believe and keep believing and hoping in Christ, that we will really see the goodness of the Lord in our lives. Once during a very difficult time in my life, my wife quoted me this verse and it got me through by believing to see God's help in that particular time for a very specific situation that I felt helpless in. God is faithful and he is good.
Will you please stand, and we're going to pray for the service. Father, we thank you for this glorious Easter morning when we can remember that we need never lose heart and that your promises are sure as the sun rising after the darkest night. May everyone here be encouraged and celebrate that Jesus took death captive, rising from the dead, and that we live in the land of hope, in the land of the living. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come let us worship our King. Come let us bow at his
of the reasons why I love celebrating Easter. It's why I love celebrating the resurrection, because God in the gospel of Jesus has nothing to do with modifying you. Has nothing to do with making you, you are a decent person, now you're going to make you a good person. The gospel has nothing to do with that. See, the gospel says that you are dead in your sins and transgressions. And I want to make you alive. And so there are things in our life that we have been trying to modify. We've been trying to customize. We've been trying to control. And God says, would you just die to that? Would you allow the resurrection power that was in Christ when he raised him from the dead, the same one that's available to us today? Would you allow me to be alive? Because I want to make you alive. So I want to go, kind of jump into our time together. Can we just put our hands out in front of us? You've done weirder things. If this is your first time in church, you've done much weirder things. It's okay. God, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your creativity. We thank you for the fact that you didn't just create us, but you went out and you rescued us. Lord, even when we made decisions based off our own free will, Lord, you come after us. And you say, I'm still gonna make a way. And so God, we celebrate today that you are good and that you came for us, that we may not only know of your goodness, but we may walk in your goodness. And so, Lord, we celebrate you today. Jesus, you are our resurrected King. And we come before you with thanksgiving and excitement and a desire to want to be a part of your kingdom. And so, Lord, would you teach us today? Would you meet us today? In Jesus' name, we all said amen, amen. Come on, let's give him praise. Hey, why don't you go ahead and use this time, go say hi to someone. If you're on this side, come to this side, that side, this side. Then also use the time to scoot in a little bit. If you've got extra space, scoot in a little bit. Let's make room for everybody.
Let the house of the Lord Hello, hello. Good morning, everyone. Happy Easter. Man, all you look so good this morning. This is so awesome. Good morning, Eric. Thank you. Hi, guys. My name is Ashley. I'm one of the assisting pastors here at The Well. Also, this morning, I am the online host, so for those of you joining us online, I'll be back in the chat shortly, dropping in those links, no worries. But this morning, I am so excited that I get to say hello and welcome and happy Easter. Ooh. I was like, I know it's early, I know it's raining, but hello, I'm glad we all got to make it out here. For those of you joining us for the first time, extra special welcome. In the seat backs in front of you, we actually have something called a response card. We just want to get to know you better, keep you updated to what's happening here at The Well. So if you want to fill that out and head to the cafe after service to the welcome table, we'll have Courtney there. You could go ahead and give this to her, and we have a free gift for you. And those joining us online for the first time, I will be dropping a link that you could also fill out your information, and we'll mail that gift to you as well. Also, for everyone here on these response cards, if you want more information, we also have an area here that you could check off what you want more information on, and you could turn that in at the welcome table as well, or we have the joy box near the entrance of the sanctuary. And here in this box, we have a prayer, praise, comment. If you have a prayer request or a praise report, we want to partner with you in that. We believe prayer changes things. We have a team here that is dedicated to praying over these every week. So please, if you are going through something, you want to share something, please write it down. You could drop it off at the Joy Box or at the cafe at one of the tables. And also, as I said, today is Easter. That was pretty good. That was better than the first time I said it's Easter. But happy Easter, everyone. We are so excited that we are celebrating with you. Yes, this might get more cheers. We have our donut wall out. That's fair. We have our donut wall out. So after service, grab a donut, hang out, just spend some time here in community. We also have our family portraits happening. So we already had people come in for their time slots that they signed up in the morning. But we have time slots after service as well. So if you signed up for that, we'll have Willie and Jen over at the check-in area in the cafe. There will be signs. You can go ahead and meet up with one of them, and they'll get you checked in and ready for your family photos. Also, looking forward in April. Can you believe April's like tomorrow? But at the end of April, we have Discover Workshops. So if you are new to the church, if you're new to Jesus, if you want more information about, you want to get baptized, or more information about becoming a church member, we want to invite you to attend one of our Discover Workshops where we can give you more information on that. That'll be April 28th at the after service. You can sign up on the Church Center app or head over to the events table in the cafe, and we can get you signed up as well. And happening right now, we have our small groups. So small group seasons is happening, and it's just honestly a better, like, how do I say this? I don't want to say a better. It's an amazing way. We'll say that. It's an amazing way to discover and encounter the love of Jesus in a deeper way in community, that you are with a group of people kind of like maybe in a similar spot as you, maybe who might have already figured some things out, or maybe also have questions that you might have answers to. And it's just honestly a good time to hang out with people. We have groups happening all throughout the week for all ages. So you can head over to the events table and we can find a group that's suited for you guys. But as we transition into a different posture of worship, we believe that generosity leads to joy. And one of the ways we get to do that is through our tithes and offering, where our tithe is 10% of our monthly income given to our local church. And we get to remain on God's wisdom. That's not right either. Man. Thank you. It's different R words. Here we are. We get to rely and remain in God. We get to rely on God's wisdom for the remaining. That's where the remain was. That's where it was. The remaining 90%. Imagine if I have mixed up those two. So. Oh, guys, we got this. So. the remaining 90%, we get to live with our hands wide open and trusting who God is and what he is our provider. And we also know we have an offering. That's the above and beyond gift that the Lord has placed on your heart. There are four ways to give. We have online, text, mail, and our joy box near the entrance of the sanctuary. And I just want to pray over us all as we are diving into our series of Romans and hearing what the Lord has for us. So if you could lift up your Bibles, your note-taking devices, we're just going to pray over this time. Hi, God, I just want to give you this morning. Lord, I thank you that we all got here safely. Lord, that you have a purpose for all of us here. Lord, that maybe it's the 100th time we're here, or maybe it's the first time in a long time, God. But you have such a special plan for us. So, Lord, I pray that as this morning goes on, that we are hearing you and your words, Lord. And I just want to give this day to you. In your name, Jesus, amen.
Amen. Let's give it up for Ashley. Way to go. Hey, it's your first time doing this. Do it on Easter. Oh, man. Hey, so glad you guys are here. If you have an empty seat, just, you know, you can scoot in a little bit. We have a few more coming in. I just want to make sure we give room for all that. So it rained like crazy this weekend. So it's one of the things is good, but all of us Californians are like, ew. What is this stuff? And so I'm glad you made it. You did it. Did it. Good. I love that this year is followed by, this Easter is followed by April Fools. And I just get like warnings all through March from my kids that say, beware. And I just never know. One year they put soap in my toothpaste. But it was like Bed Bath & Beyond. No, not, what's it called? Bath and Body Works, whatever. Whatever. I'm like, it's not bad, but there's something different. And then you just realize it later on. And you're like, oh, I might be sick later. But I am so glad to celebrate Easter here with you today. We are in the book of Romans. We have been for the last couple of weeks. And we're going to continue in there because sometimes you can take a break, go, now we're going to tell the resurrection story. And if you really only come to church on Easter, like, I've heard the same story over and over again. Like, the church just plays reruns. And so we're going to continue in our series in Romans. And what's really cool is looking at Romans chapter 8, Paul, which is a guy who's so against Christians, like anti-Christian, like you think, like anti-Christian. Like now people are just like, oh, I don't like you. But Paul, what he would do, he would actually like go into your home, take you and your family out, bring you out in front of people, and you either be imprisoned or killed. So Paul really didn't like Christians. But then he had a radical encounter with Jesus. Jesus appears to him and says, why are you persecuting me? And so this guy who went from going after Christians, he started building the church. He started preaching the gospel. He started edifying the church. And now even 2,000 years later, his words continue to teach us. And so he's kind of finishing up in here in chapter 8, this big section kind of explaining the theology, because Romans is a big theology book, which, by the way, theology means the study of God. It's this understanding of kind of addressing a lot of heresy and even just some just false teaching that was going on, and just kind of bringing in a solidified theology here. And so one of the big things he's talking about is this: all of us, no matter if you are non-religious, there is you have seen the glory of God. If you stepped outside, looked at the rain, looked at the stars, looked at the mountains. By the way, there is a ton of snow on the mountains. So spring breakers, you know, don't go to the beach, go to the mountains. Anyway. We have one more day spring break, so I'm thinking about it. Anyway, God has revealed his glory, revealed his goodness through creation. So even if you don't believe in God, there's plenty of evidence around, and we're going to get more detail that in the summer coming up in our truth series, that there's enough evidence to go, wow, there's something bigger than me. There's something greater than me. But then there are those who are really religious and they do all the right things and they have a law and they stick to the law and their thing is like, if I stick to the law, then I'm good with God. And what Paul's saying here, he says, hey, whether if you know God or don't know God, you're kind of both in the same boat. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. God gave us all an opportunity in the garden to say, hey, do you want just my goodness? Or do you want the knowledge of good and evil? And we're all like, give us the evil. we want that. And so now we get to experience good and evil. And so really, in this world, as a Christian, if you know Jesus, this place we live now, earth, this is the closest to hell you're ever going to get. You know, that scab knee, that disease, that heartache, this is the closest to hell you're ever going to get. But if you're not a believer in Jesus, well, the Bible says this is actually going to be the closest to heaven you're ever going to get. You're going to get the love. You're going to get the joy. You're going to get the excitement. You're going to get the taste of an In-N-Out burger. But after death, like one of those things, like God doesn't send people to hell, but it's this idea of if you didn't want relationship with God on earth, why would you want relationship with him with eternity? You know? And so he goes, you've made your choice. And so Paul is really outlining this, and he's coming to bring this all in conclusion. Because how many of us know in this world, whether it's you turn on the news or just try to get out of bed, it's you're ready, you're eager for something better. Anyone else in here? You're like, do I have to really worry that much when I go shopping? Like, do I have to really worry about, you know, locking my car and doing all these things? Like, it's just kind of crazy. Or do I really have to have this back pain or this disease or snap, crackle, pop in the morning? You're just like walking. You know, like, we all can recognize that things are not the way they should be. Yay, nay? Okay. We just yayed that. I just realized. Okay. And so what Paul's going to make this argument is that all creation is eager for new life. We're eager for new life. And so we're going to start here in Romans 8, chapter 19. And it says, for all creation is waiting eagerly for the future day when God will reveal who his children are. Against its will, all creation was subjugated to God's curse. It's this separation from God. That's what that God's curse means. But with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. For we know that all creation has been groaning as in pains of childbirth right up to the present time. All humanity, all creation, we're hungering for relief. Have you ever been so hungry, you're just like your stomach's growling nonstop? That's when you get to that place where Taco Bell does look good. You know, it's never your first choice, but it's your desperate choice, right? Or if you're ever just, you're like, I need something, I'm thirsty. And so I don't know about you, but growing up in the 90s, like we thought if you drank a soda, that meant you got hydrated. Anyone else get in trouble for having water bottles at your table, at your desk? Like you're like, I'm thirsty. Or in sports, you're like, if you're thirsty, you're weak. Keep running. Like, no, we are so hungry and we're thirsty. We desire this. We crave this. We crave food. We crave companionship. We crave a relief of pain. That's why addictions are so prevalent. Not because they're fun. Because for a moment, you experience relief. For a moment, it doesn't hurt as much. Whether that be an Advil pill or whiskey or whatever you want to say what it is, that's that moment where it's like, okay, that hunger, that eagerness for freedom in life was quenched for a second. And so we keep chasing after it. Verse 23 says, and we believers, so now he's addressing those who know Christ, we also groan. We also have this desire. Even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste of future glory, for we long for our bodies to be released from sin and suffering. We too, we wait with eager hope on the day when God will give us full rights as his adopted children, including the new bodies he has promised us. We were given this hope when we were saved. It's talking about the followers of Jesus. There's a bodily resurrection. And because I know my wife is a praying woman, I will resurrect looking like Chris Hemsworth. You know, a little bit tall, a little bit tighter. But it's this idea that we know that the suffering will end. Revelation 21 tells us that there will be no more pain, no more suffering, no more tears of pain, but tears of joy. And this is what's crazy is even in the midst of suffering, and this is what makes Yahweh and the story of the gospel of Jesus so unique, especially in this culture and time, is that if you look back on your 10th grade history, you learn about the Greek gods, the Roman gods, they looked at the biggest planet in the solar system, and we're going to name that Jupiter, because he's strong, he's big. Like, it's exciting, it's flawless. It's like we there's this worship of greatness. But then you have the gospel of Jesus that says that Jesus was going to come and he was going to suffer. What kind of God suffers? The God that's like you and I. The God who sent his son to suffer like you and I suffer. This isn't some big god named Jupiter who is just big, or Zeus, this giant, flawless. Though God was perfect, though Jesus was perfect, he suffered. Because we suffer. We know that pain. We know that feeling. And so in verse 26, and as the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. Every other Roman god, every other religion in this time was saying that if you're weak, it's because you are so undesirable to the gods. But here we have Paul telling us that it's the Holy Spirit that helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father who knows all hearts knows that the Spirit is saying, the Spirit pleads for us as believers in harmony with God's will. Isn't it good to know that when we pray, it doesn't have to be, thou sayest the Lordeth, I come to theeth. Sometimes praying to the Lord is, ah. Are you kidding me? Isn't it good to know that's prayer?
Yeah.
That when you stub your toe and you go, Jesus Christ, you're praying? You're not cursing? Maybe if you use other words, you're just like, I'm just Pentecostal. But there's this groaning. God doesn't desire our perfection. He desires our hearts because he's the one that's perfect. And so we see this verse, and this is a really familiar verse. You can see this at your local Hobby Lobby. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purposes for them. Now, a quick note on that verse. This verse is not a promise to avoid suffering.
That's right.
This verse is a promise that he is with you in your suffering.
That's right.
Because the end of suffering is in heaven. So if you're living on this earth, go, man, if I get the right car, the right wife, or the right husband, or the right amount of money, the right job, or the right this and that, then I'm going to experience no suffering. Good luck. Richest man, one of the most prophetic people in our time, Steve Jobs, with all the money he had, with all the technology he had, he died of pancreatic cancer. No matter what you have, God is with you in your suffering. For God knew his people in advance. He chose them to become like his son, that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, called them to come to him. Having called them, gave them the right standing with himself. And having given them the right standing, he gave them glory. This is an important note that we've been mentioning the last few weeks. But you can't make yourself right with God. God made himself right with you. And all you have to do is accept and walk in that free gift. And so in verse 31, we get the Easter story. So if you came for the Easter story, guess what? You get it. Here in the book of Romans 8:31, what shall we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can be against us? Since he did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give us everything else? Who dare accuses us whom God has chosen for his own? No one, for God himself has given us right standing with himself. For who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ Jesus died for us, was raised to life for us, and he is sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand for us. This is the gospel story. The whole point of Jesus going to the cross and resurrecting was for you and I. But it's because of his goodness, not yours. You didn't like save up enough good person coupons for Jesus come rise on, you know, die and rise on the third day for you. You're like, I'm coming to redeem my target points. You know, like, no, you will come up short every single time. Jesus does it because his love for us. Earlier in Romans, it said, even while we were still yet sinners, Jesus died for us. Man, that's good news. Sometimes we hear sinners. Sinners also, it's behavior, but it's also just our state of humanity. God just, he chased after us. He suffered for us, not as a symbol, but he literally suffered to raise from the dead to defeat sin, inviting you and I to follow him in freedom. So here's the question then. Most of us have heard the story. We've grown up in the United States and we see Christendom. We've heard the gospel story, all these different, we know these things. But here's the question in 35 that Paul's asking, the Romans is asking you and I. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean that he no longer loves us when we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened by death? Have you ever asked yourself that question? That you maybe did something so bad or so terrible or so contrary to your character or so contrary to scripture in your own, I don't even know how God could love me anymore. I've walked away. I've purposely said, I don't believe this anymore. What if, I was told one time when we planted the church, you know, we weren't seeing what we wanted to see at first, and I had a friend tell me, he goes, well, maybe God's just not happy with you. I'm like, that's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. You know, you're allowed to say that when people give you advice. Most of the time we go, oh, thank you. I'm never going to do that. I think some people need to be told, you have dumb advice. Go do better. Anyway. But this is a reality. And I've heard this. People go, man, I just got baptized last week and then this person died in my life. I just gave my life to Jesus and suddenly all these things are going wrong. Does it mean that because I have difficulties in life that God doesn't love me? No. Difficulties are not a sign of God's disapproval. It's a sign of you're human on earth. It's not as heaven yet. You're human on earth. What if something terrible happens in life? What if people start hating me because of my faith? What if I can't find a job? What if I have no money? What if my life is being threatened? What if people are trying to go kill me? Like, no. Despite all these things in verse 37, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. We have Jesus. So when we go through difficult things, our temptation is to walk away. When that's why he showed up, we need to walk toward. We don't run from God, we run to God. He begins to teach, he begins to help us, he begins to comfort. It says the Holy Spirit is close to the brokenhearted. Yet we go, nope, God hates me, later. I'm gonna go try something else. God's gone, you didn't even try. But Paul's going to take it further in verse 38. He says, I am convinced that nothing can separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, nor our fears for today, nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed. Nothing in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. And what's so cool about this verse, it addresses our physical needs, death nor life, angel nor demon. It addresses our emotional needs, fears for today, nor not our worries for tomorrow. You know what that's called? Anxiety and depression. Just because you feel alone does not mean you are. Just because you're worried does not mean that you don't trust God. It means you're learning to trust God. This is so crucial and important to understand, especially with our mental health. Just because you are struggling does not mean you don't have enough faith. That's right. You just have to have a little bit. And you being here shows that you have a little bit. You still choosing to breathe shows you have just a little bit. And that's all that God desires. And he addresses our spiritual needs that there's no power in hell that would separate us from the love of Jesus. The suffering on the cross and the glory of the resurrection invites us to live a life of freedom. Live a life of freedom. I don't know if you guys liked being chained up and just being told to do everything and having no control. I don't. And the camera crew's like, yeah, we know. Following Jesus isn't about following a bunch of rules. It's about pursuing the author of all creation. It's about walking with Jesus. It's not about do this, don't that, do this, don't do that. Well, you do this, you're gonna do that. No, Jesus completed the law. And now we just come after Jesus. Well, what about my poor behavior? Well, let Jesus take care of that. Does that mean that in your pursuit of holiness, your pursuit to be more like Jesus, I guarantee you'll be much less of a jerk. This is what's great. You find, you know, there's a lot of grumpy Christians out there. Just open up Facebook. Because you can know the word of God. You can know Jesus. You can live in that fear of, oh, we better be worried. The government's doing this, so that we have to be scared. And no, we walk with Jesus. So if you're going to pursue legalism and religiosity, you're going to be constantly in fear and grumpy. But if you would just follow your Savior, if you would just do what Jesus does, instead of being afraid, you're compassionate. Instead of being judgmental, you're curious. And you just begin to follow Jesus. There's so much freedom in following Jesus. So number one, I got my 3 points for you. Don't worry. Here's your Easter message. I know you're worried. You're like, it's 10:04. I don't have 3 points yet. Number one, write this down. Celebrate in the freedom that God is for us. Man, when you have the security that God is for you, you have that security that he loves you. Can you imagine if you stopped going, well, I messed up today. God doesn't love me. Well, I've got to start all over from the beginning. Can you imagine if we just got over that and go, God loves you, move on. Yeah. He loves you. Now pursue him, chase after him. This is that joy and that celebration. That's why I say we celebrate it that God is for us. We do not have to live in fear or be concerned about where we stand with God. Because you don't have to get right with God. He already got right with you. God's for you. God's the one on the cheer going, let's go, let's go. We got this. I'm watching, I'm cheering you on. He's not back there going, oh, there's another mistake. That must have been the bad dust I created them with. No. Some of you are like, thanks, Dad. He is so for you. You were creating his image and his likeness way before you were a sinner. His original design was to be in his image and likeness. And because we now feel the ramifications of death, the ramifications of disease, his heart yearned so much for you, he chased after you with Jesus. So number two, not only do we get to celebrate, it's one of my favorite ones, you ready? Rest. Rest in the freedom that God is with us. This is what's so important. Do you know that God desires relationship with you? You know, out after Judaism, the completion of the covenant into Christianity and what Jesus does, it's the only faith that says, take a break. God loves you for more than who you are than what you can do for him. It's so crazy. Like one of the rules that the Old Testament talks about, and it's a really good rule, and it's funny that this is the one we fight more than anything. You're like, I'll stop doing the bad things. But take a day off? That's how I know this. I know a lot of Christians who are faithful believers in Jesus. They are discipled. They have cast away their old life. They have their new self on them, but they still don't take a day off to just rest. A recent study came out that said if you take a day off once a week, your health improves everyone who knows the Bible for 8,000 years went, no, duh. This is what's so important. You know, any relationship that you have, any human relationship you have, whether it's your spouse, kids, a friend, there is something in gaining relationship as you do something. But one of the most powerful things is when you just sit with each other. You just hang out. That may be playing cards or watching Netflix or taking a walk. That may be just going on a road trip and just talking with each other. Sitting under a tree, going to the beach, like just spending time uninterrupted, your phone's away. You're like, you can stop right there, preacher man. Knock that off. Growing a relationship with Jesus is a lot like growing a relationship with people. You know a little bit about them, maybe their favorite color. Maybe, you know, if they like pineapple on their pizza or something. And you decided to stick around, you'll deal with crazy. But then you grow into the deeper things. Hey, why do you act that way when your family's around? Why do you shut down when the argument starts? Can we talk through that? That's the deep heart stuff, but that can only happen when we rest in the freedom that God is with us. You don't have to determine the relationship with him. He's for you. Yeah. So you can pursue him, and you can also rest in him. Number three, we live in the freedom that we are invited to walk in the ways of Jesus. We're invited to walk in the ways of Jesus. Jesus didn't just come to die on the cross, but he also came as a teacher. And he taught. And he's still teaching us today through his scripture and to how to interact with people. There's even some stuff in how to run a business, how to be a servant leader instead of a dominating one, how to love your neighbor. You know, half the stuff, if we just learned how to love our neighbor, we wouldn't be trying to shoot them and attack them and have war with them. Like, what if we just allowed him to teach us? And by the way, you're being taught by somebody. Everyone in this room is being taught by somebody. Right. Some of you, it's CNN. Some of you, it's Fox News. Some of you, it's because it's what your dad told you to do, what your mom told you to do, or it's what your culture has taught you to do, or it's because the movies you watch. It's really interesting. Our generation's heroes are all movie characters. Actors. So it is scary to come across something so genuine, so authentic, that when you read scripture, it reads you. And that's why you go, nope. I remember when I read Matthew in the first time of the parable of the sower, where he's talking about some seed fell on good soil, some seed on the concrete, on the rocks, and some seed, you know, in the thorns. I'm going, I am so in the thorns. I don't want to hear that. No, I'm just going to just keep doing my thing. I'm great. I'm fine. But we're invited to a life of repentance and forgiveness. Can you imagine where our marriages would be if we repented toward one another, if we forgave one another? And this was crazy. If we're so secure in God's love, we get the invitation to now be secure in the love with other people. We get to learn a new way. We get to learn a new kingdom culture. Because our culture, whether it's the last 20 years or the last 200 years or the last 2,000 years, we haven't figured it out yet as a society. We have some people that, you know, have used the Bible to hurt people. We have some people that say, well, just ignore the Bible. Well, what if we just did what Jesus did? What if we stopped using this as something to avoid or a weapon and just used it as something to teach us how to live? It's really difficult to hate your neighbor when you're learning from Jesus. What if we said yes to his kingdom culture? So my invitation here is I just want us to live in freedom. I want to invite you, would you live in freedom? Would you choose Jesus daily? It's great that we celebrate the cross and the resurrection on Easter during the Holy Week. Maybe we had a great Good Friday service. What if it just wasn't once a year? What if it wasn't just when we needed it? What if we just made the commitment, say, I want to live like Jesus did. I want to love people like Jesus did. I want to honor people. I want to say I'm sorry a lot. And I want to forgive people and receive forgiveness well.
Praise God.
What if we did that? What if we just said, it's not about me, it's about you. I think one of the most powerful verses in John is actually John the Baptist. This is right before he goes and he's actually beheaded. But he says this, would God increase so that I may decrease? You know what happens when we decrease later on in scripture? It says that those who humble themselves, the Lord will lift them up. What if we look at Easter not just as Jesus' death and resurrection, but my death and resurrection? What if we chose to die to ourselves and say, Jesus, teach me. Jesus, lead me, because I want to follow you. We're going to give you something as you walk out later today. Not later today, like you're here for a few more hours. Sorry, in a few minutes. That just went from church to a hostage situation. Gosh. Words matter. But we want to give you a gift. And before you see the gift, because when I first saw it, I went, no. Because this isn't about being religious. This is about following Jesus. And so we want to give you something that's going to help remind you of the freedom that we have in Christ to walk with Jesus. But what we're going to give you may make you think that it's special, but it's just a reminder, okay? So I'm really trying to preface this. This is a gift that I want you, not as a religious relic, but a reminder of his love and the freedom and the joy that you have in Jesus. So wherever you may put this, this is not something to be worshiped. This is something to inspire you and to remind you of your peace. So simply, it's just a little cross. It's just a little cross. To be reminded of our freedom that we have in Christ. And that freedom is beyond any other freedom anyone can promise. It's Jesus and Jesus alone. So I'm going to invite the worship team up. I want us to take some time to just reflect, to respond to what this is. Jesus' death and resurrection is an invitation for our death and resurrection. And if you've never given your life to Jesus, my encouragement to you as we spend this time in just prayers, this time in worship, that we would take this time to lean into that. That we would take this time to really think, what are you going to say to his invitation? Now, some of you in here, you've already said yes to Jesus. You're like, oh yeah, I RSVP'd, I'm good. Jesus and I I've accepted that gift. My invitation for you is you just ask the Holy Spirit to fill you. Because as a follower of Jesus, you are also now a sent person to proclaim the gospel to all the world. And so would you even in that moment just ask as we worship, Holy Spirit, would you fill me? Holy Spirit, would you cover me from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet? Would you empower me to see people as you see people? So I want to invite all of us to stand. We're going to do two songs together. And I want us to just lean into this. You, right after this time, you can do whatever you want. And you will do whatever you want. And there'll be 1,000 things that are grabbing your attention. Maybe your stomach's grabbing your attention right now. But for this next 10 minutes, don't just make Easter about, oh, cool, I went to Easter service, check. Would you seek after him? Would you seek after his face? And so, Lord God, we just come before you. I want to invite anyone in this room who's never given their life to Jesus. And you want to do that today. I want to ask if you would you just raise your hand? And it's not out of anything weird. It's just making a physical response to what God is maybe speaking to your heart and to your mind right now. If that's you, just go ahead and just raise your hand. Someone look across here. Amen. Go ahead. And this is just your declaration of God. And if you're raising your hand right now, or maybe you're struggling, I want you to pray this with me. Because in Romans it says we're justified by our faith that we may have peace through God, our Lord Jesus Christ. But would you pray this with me? Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins and surrender my life. Wash me clean. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died on the cross for my sin and rose again on the third day for my freedom. I believe this to be true and make this confession that Jesus is my Savior and Lord. Teach me your ways and lead me all the days of my life. And so, Lord, we come before you with celebration and with joy. As we worship together, can we just take that moment, just lean after him, and we'll celebrate together as we can.
All hail King Jesus. All hail King Jesus. that everything we do is for you. And so we just continue to respond that way today, God, in everything that we do, even outside of these walls, Lord. May everything just be about you and for you. We're going to end on this song as we celebrate the resurrection, as we celebrate who God is. Amen. I'm not in the right key. I'm so sorry. There it is. Thank you.
people who have your 11:15 time slot, you're like, hurry up, Eric, let's go. I want to encourage you, if you said yes to Jesus, I'm going to invite Aaron over here and then Chris Guerrero, if you're in here, I see you somewhere. I text you. Yeah, come on now. If you said yes to Jesus for the first time today, these two pastors want to pray for you. They have some resources to give you. And so as we finish our time together, before you head out, please come be prayed for and get that stuff for you. If this is your first time to the Well, my encouragement, if it's here or somewhere else, if you don't have a home church, I invite you to find a home church, whether that's here or somewhere else. But part of your growth, part of you following Jesus, is getting to do it with a bunch of other people who are still trying to figure it out. Because we're not after perfection, right? We're after Jesus. And so to do that with other people, I want to invite you to be a part of that. And the other thing is just begin to read your Bible. Begin to pray. You may go, I have no idea what that just said. That's okay. Just continue to read. This is a book that is part of the way Holy Spirit speaks to us. So I would encourage you to do that. If you need a Bible, let us know. That's what those response cards are for. Whether they say yes, Jesus, or you need a Bible, whatever you need, we want to help you in that process. Well, I'm going to pray for you. We're here at the Well. We'd like to end our time. Go ahead and grab the person's hand next to you. And we're going to pray us out. And God, I thank you for all that you are. God, we thank you for every person in this room, Lord, who is saying yes to freedom, yes to Jesus, whether for me for the first time or the first time for the 100th time, to recommit or to just say, I'm going to chase after you. God, we pray that you take the dead things that you have called to be alive and make them alive. God, we thank you for your resurrection and that way, that invitation for our resurrection. God, we thank you for all that you are. Pray blessing and favor over the person to our left, to our right, in front of us, and behind us. Lord, would you speak to them? Would you grab a hold of their heart? Grab a hold of their mind, and that they may find freedom in Christ Jesus. In your precious name, we all said, amen, amen. Come on, let's give him praise. Okay, go ahead and grab your gift on the way out, and then if you want to be prayed for, you want to say yes to Jesus, go ahead and come down here, be prayed by one of our pastors. Donut wall is that way. If you go that way, you don't get a donut. You gotta go that way, get the donut.